Hi.
So I've always got a quandary about where to point the camera. Do I point it at the radios or do I point it out the window? And by the way, I'm just getting ready to leave Austin. This will be the first on-the-road video. The direction I'm taking out of Austin doesn't show downtown. It'll be kind of boring, so I decided to show the radios for a minute. But first, I need to update the program because I'm heading back a different way. This is the interface to the ICOM radio. I didn't have time to put together a software for the Yaesu 8900. So I'll be updating just the D-Star repeaters in the ICOM 2820. I'm going to be going through New Orleans area, and I'm staying somewhere in that area. So I'm going to program just through there. I've been running behind like crazy. So I can't really see everything, but I'm plugging this into the USB port over here on the computer, which is running RT Systems. I'm clicking Communications, Send Data to Radio. It tells me to turn the radio off and insert the cable. Well, I've done that. The radio is off. And then turn the radio on. So the radio is on. Click OK to send data. Oh, click OK. There we go. And I think you can read this. It says clone in, and it is sucking up the data from the software. And it's going pretty fast. It's about halfway there. I have programmed D-Star repeaters from Austin, not much between here and Houston, then East Texas and into Louisiana. There's some big gaps in the D-Star coverage. So that is done. Turn the radio off, turn the radio on. And I have set this stuff. First of all, I'm going to put it in single mode. And I have set this stuff in banks. I've got a bank for 2 meters, the 144 band. That bank just has all of the 2 meter frequencies in it, step by step. And you'll notice these are the 20 kilohertz channels here at the bottom of the band. A repeater ID, but at the top end of the band, we're at the 15 kilohertz channels. But that's not the way Texas is. Texas is 20 kilohertz channels. They were one of the first places, maybe the first place to go do that. So I've also, some DNFRS. I've also got, and here's the banks that have the D-Star stuff in it. So we'll be going back to the Texas D-Star in a minute. But I've got this bank for 20 kilohertz channels. And once again, on the bottom of the band, looks the same. But when we get up into the top half, the 146 section, even the simplex channels are different. 20 kilohertz steps. 5.2 is the same. A lot of the frequencies will be the same as the 50 kilohertz channel steps, but many of them will be different. So 6.4 is the same, but 6.2 is different. 6.6 is different. If you're in a 15 kilohertz area, some of these look odd. 7.2 doesn't look right. 7.4 doesn't look right. 7.6 looks right. 7.8 doesn't look right. 8.0 doesn't look right. 8.2 looks right. Someday Bill Pasternak and I and maybe a few other people will talk about these differences. So anyway, we've got that set up, but I'm going to go back to the Texas D-Star, and these two will be the only ones I can hear from here. GPS light is still blinking. It takes a long time for the GPS to lock on the 2820. Every other GPS I've got around here locks pretty fast. Let me show you what I did on the listening to 144.39 over there on that side. I've got the Kenwood. It's out of sight under the computer, and it's just kind of temporarily tie-wrapped to an arm on the computer here. Okay. If I swing this out, can you see it? Sort of. There it is. So we'll turn that on. The radio is just sitting on the seat, and the control head is just kind of tie-wrapped down here. Turn the beacon on. And now you can find me on APRS.fi. And the 2820 is still hunting. I got to be fair to the 2820. The actual GPS antenna is not sitting right at a window. It's sitting down a foot or so. It eventually locks and stays locked, but it takes a long, long time. So I think I'm just about ready to go. I was going to show you what I did with programming for the analog radio, the 8900. And I think you can read that if you've got a high-def receiver. There are a lot of frequencies to program in. Any given area, you'll get a dozen or more. And probably not going to spend very much time, if any, on any of those repeaters, so it's not worth a lot of time and effort for over the road. I want to do a program where I get a lot more into detail about that sort of thing. So I just kind of grabbed them wholesale. I didn't, except for Austin here. In Austin, I put the frequency AUST78, AUST84. Is there a repeater there? Not keying them up. 88. Yep.
5KA repeater.
There they are. How about 90? Are they there? Yep, 90 is there. I should really ID. KN4AQ. KN4AQ. Now somebody's going to call me. Let's check both of these. There's a 94A and a 94B because the repeater directory showed two different. Well, one's got a tone and one doesn't. That's odd. But it doesn't key up without a tone. With a tone, it does. KN4AQ Mobile Austin. But only in a few places did I bother to put any frequency information. Mostly, I would just put the name and, like, is that Georgetown, I think? Which is really just a suburb of Austin. Waco. Now, here's a whole bunch of frequencies that just say Waco. I don't know what any of them are, and I don't really care. If I want to see the frequency, I can look at the specific frequency just by holding the low button in. I've discovered that that's a bit of a problem because the only thing I see change is this little memory number, and it's not really all that easy to see, especially when you're driving. So I can improve on this, but for Waco that I just kind of blew through, it wasn't really worth doing a lot. You know, I can just key up and see what, you know, what comes back. I think Waco's out of range, so nothing is going to come back. Anyway, that's the way I set that up. I really like to do a program with more in-depth how I do this and how I decide what it is I'm going to do. But for now, that's an idea of how the radios are all set up. So I'm going to stop recording for a minute, make sure I'm ready to get on the road, and I'll go play some radio as we drive down the road. I'll let you keep looking at the radios for a little while. I think we're good. Tune the Austin 9-4, because I need the 9-4B, which was pretty busy all day yesterday, but it's not very busy today. I'll leave APRS kind of going in the background there, and maybe you can hear some of the beeps from the Kenwood. I discovered there were some pretty long gaps in APRS coverage, and from looking at APRS.fi, the territory that I'm headed to, it looks like there will be some more pretty big gaps in between the metro areas. But here, it's pretty busy. I kind of wonder about APRS. It is so interesting and so much fun to play with when you've got radio set up for it. And this Kenwood D700 is pretty good, although having played with the Yaesu FTM 400 with the built-in GPS receiver, I think they call it a green light GPS dongle that sticks off the control head of the 700, is a little clunkier. But I do have to say, because having discovered that the GPS receiver in the Yaesu is not super sensitive, this GPS box dongle hanging off the D700 is very sensitive and locks fast. It locks within about a second or so of being turned on, so it is pretty impressive. It locks so fast, there's a little GPS indicator on the display, and some devices, the GPS indicator blinks while it is searching and goes solid when it has found the GPS. That's the way the GPS indicator, which is still blinking on the 2820, works. So looking at the display on the D700, the GPS indicator was blinking. And it was blinking for a long time, and I'm thinking, well, that's disappointing. It's not locking up. Well, it turns out its indication is the opposite of those that blink. It is blinking when it is locked, and it is solid when it is not locked. And after I paid a little bit more attention to it, I discovered that it locks fast. So maybe I'm not that unhappy having a little dongle hanging off of there. The 400 has a prettier, perhaps more useful display for APRS, and of course the stuff that it does on C4FM, if that takes off. But I've had this 700 for a while. It cost quite a bit of money when I bought it, so much that it's kind of a shame that I didn't use it for a long time and only just took it out of the box to be able to play with it on this trip at the very last minute, using time that I did not have in getting things prepared. So, and you didn't see any GPS stuff from me because I didn't have the right button pushed. There's a button on the display to turn the beacon on and off, and everything was working. It's just I wasn't sure that the GPS was working, and I didn't know I needed to push that button. So once I got that all figured out, suddenly everything has been working. And you can go to aprs.fi and see where I've been since about Jackson, Mississippi, on the way out, and you can see all the holes in APRS coverage. And finally, I am getting on the highway. So I've made a bunch of programs with Bob Berninga. I haven't talked to him one-on-one. Someday I'd really like to do that. The inventor of APRS, WB4APR, Bob Berninga, would really like people to not stop using it for location service, but to use all the other stuff he's put into it and all the other things that he would like to have in it and make it all work. And so many things I can't even remember to list them because all I've ever used it for is location. I've also seen that there's beaconing. You can put stuff in. Every repeater in town can show up on the map, but not every repeater in town does, because only a few people in town have bothered to put their repeater on the map. But if you've got an APRS display, you should be able to drive into a town and see where all the repeaters are and see what their coverage is. You know, it can show their height above average terrain, their actual location, not just the center of the city, assuming that they want to reveal their actual location. And for some repeaters, that can be a security issue, so they might not want to say exactly where they are, but they can offset it a little bit. And then you look around for the tall tower and you guess where the repeater really is. You can message people. You can message people who are on APRS anywhere. You can message people on the internet. I'm not sure you can receive messages back from the internet, but you do have that capability and lots of other things that Bob has talked about and just about nobody uses. The thing I wonder about, and I've got to ask, is that APRS is already pretty busy. Been hearing the packets go by, and I'm in a mobile, you know, so I'm not hearing nearly what the digipeater is hearing that covers this area. So it's probably pretty busy and there really aren't that many people using it. So the question is, when does it get saturated? When does the channel just get so busy handling packets that no more users can be accommodated? Now, they've worked with ways to limit the traffic and to reduce the number of retransmissions and how far your signal gets retransmitted in RF, which takes up space on the channel, takes up time on the channel. And they may have that about as fine-tuned as it can be, or there may be more they can do. There may be a way to offload some of the traffic. The stuff that goes between the digipeters and iGates doesn't have to be on 144.39. Could be on backbone frequencies. Could be on UHF. Other packet systems, the bulletin board system, went through this. It got popular enough that the channels got saturated, and they tried moving traffic off of the backbones and pushing them to other frequencies, but they discovered that everybody wanted to be on the busy frequency. It became one of those, nobody goes there anymore, it's too crowded. And I was going to say, about the time the packet bulletin board system got it figured out, no one was using it anymore because the internet took over. But I don't think they ever really got it figured out. And they knew what they needed to do. They knew what they wanted to do. They just couldn't all get coordinated and get the money together and the equipment together and the energy together and get things off of what at the time was the busy frequency, 145.01, where all the bulletin boards wanted to be. Spread them out around a geographic area and get the traffic between bulletin boards off to a UHF backbone. That would be the way to do it. At least that would be one way to do it. And it got done in some areas, got done very well in some areas, but we couldn't call it universal. A lot of areas remained congested until things just kind of died. So anyway, now APRS is still around and it is still kind of fun, but well, it could be useful if many, many, many more people adopted APRS, and I guess there'd have to be sort of an equipment conversion to make that work. Something that would make APRS just super easy for everybody to have, like having it in built into radios like the D700 or D710, and they have to, whoa, that was loud. Intermod, I guess, the D710 and the FTM400 and the handy-talkie versions of those. Beep, beep-boop. The beep is I sent a beacon, and the beep-boop is that my beacon was retransmitted by the digipeter and then sent to the APRS IS network and should show up on APRS.fi. So, but if everybody were on APRS, the system would be so grossly overloaded that it would be pretty unusable. In my opinion, and maybe somebody who knows more about APRS than I do could weigh in on that, but I know a lot about RF, I know a lot about congestion, and I think APRS is about as congested in urban areas as it can be, and something else needs to be done to alleviate that heavy traffic load. So you've been watching radios do nothing while I've been yammering at you. I guess this has been like a radio show. Maybe somebody will talk to me on 9-4. KN4AQ Mobile, heading out of Austin, back toward Raleigh, North Carolina. Spent the weekend at the DCC, spent yesterday editing video. Now, talking on the 9-4 repeater and going away. KN4AQ Mobile. N4SYZ, KN4AQ Mobile. My name is Gary, and I am eastbound, heading towards Houston.
You know, they're going to be, if the door's open at midnight, they're going to be waiting to get them, so
okay.
I guess I might as well calm down a
minute. Here's Texas, about 60 miles from Houston. And I have no idea where this repeater is, although I think I'm going by a little town called Chapel Hill. I think Brenham is a town I went through a minute or two ago, and I've been listening to the Apple announcement, turns out it's the Apple Watch, not the iWatch. And these guys are talking about it already. It's still going on.
Well, I'm sure before DARPA will know more about when they're going to be available and what kind of quantity.
And so I'm on a U.S. highway. I really prefer driving these kind of roads, although the traffic is heavier out here than typical for a U.S. highway, but there isn't really an interstate nearby, and this is the path from Austin to Houston, but it's been a lot lighter traffic than this. Just can't really get across the country efficiently on roads like this because you're slowing down every 15 miles or so for a town. And we're back in APRS coverage. There's a big hole between Austin and somewhere near here. But I can hear that I'm being digipeded. Let's turn up APRS, see what I hear out there. Which is the digipeater and which is anybody else, but I'm hearing a few signals, so I guess I'm either coming into or passing the local digipeater area. Is my GPS ever locked on the 2820? Yeah, it did. So now I'll send out location both on APRS and on D-Star. KN4A cumulable. Houston's 60 miles away. It's pretty far unless it's a really wide coverage repeater. KN4AQ mobile. Nothing. The other thing I like about being out here is you can see something off the highway. It's not just a wall of trees. Later on, when we're back on the interstate, it's just going to be a green canyon that we're going down. Didn't program any of the specific functions like echo test and link checking and things like that, things you can send in D-Star to have the repeater send you back some information. I can get there. It's a little touchy when you're driving, touching buttons to get to the menus. That puts an E in the your field of D-Star radio, and that will tell the repeater to echo me back if it's hearing me well enough. It's got to capture that data in the very first couple hundred milliseconds of my transmission. If it doesn't get that, it won't respond. Kind of high here. KN4AQ mobile testing from Hempstead, Texas.
KN4AQ mobile testing from Hempstead, Texas.
How about that? It heard me, sort of. I'm not sure what the deal is with the garble, the R2-D2 at the beginning of the transmission, why it bobbled for a while and then actually played back my entire transmission properly. That seems a little odd. We have become decidedly more urban. And just going by the, wow. This is amazing. The interchange with the Houston Beltline. I'm going to risk going pretty much through downtown, or at least one level closer Beltline. I don't know if we'll actually see the downtown skyline filling the windshield or not. I'm hearing something that I haven't heard much of or anything at all on this trip, and that's people talking on 220. I don't have a microphone over there. The microphone is back here. I can move it around, but I'm not going
to
do it in this traffic.
Again, so.
That's a guy talking on 220, and it appears to be linked to a couple of other repeaters. I think I'm hearing the same voice on 440 repeater. So I was not able to program analog repeaters for this area. But what I've got that I do whenever I'm on the road is this radio, which I laboriously programmed every 2-meter channel, 220 channel, 440 channel, 10-meter channel, 6-meter channel, 900 megahertz channel. And just let that scan, and it will show me what's what. Now, it doesn't have the 20 kilohertz steps on 2 meters. Didn't have time to put that in there, and it's not something I could copy over from the RT Systems program, because it programs with different software and they're not compatible. But it, so if it picks up a 2-meter channel, it could be 5 kilohertz off. One of the nice things this scanner does, and I don't think you're going to see its display well enough to be able to tell, is that when it stops on a channel, it very quickly tells me what tone is being sent, if any tone is being sent. So I will do a play-by-play if it stops on something. Okay, stopped on 444.3 and quickly read out 100 hertz tone. That is part one of what I wish every ham radio would do. And part two is that it would take that information and instantly put it into the transmit side of the radio and turn it on. So you tune in a repeater, traveling on the road like this. It figures out what the tone is. It turns it on. I don't have to touch anything. No ham radio does that. No ham radio even does that quick frequency counter type analysis of what the tone is. They give you this tone scan thing. It's a bunch of buttons you got to push. At least two of the best radios. Some of them mute the receive audio until it finds the tone. Some of them don't. And then you manually have to turn it on. Big pain in the butt. Manufacturers, please pay attention. Something to work at. I believe that would be not a killer app feature, but something you could advertise and would be popular. Let's see how busy APRS is. You know, earlier I heard a real blast of loud APRS, and I thought I was getting intermod. I realized what I had set up the Kenwood radio for was one of those features that Bob Bruninga put into it called Voice Alert. Oh, good. Take off my bumper merging with no turn signal. Voice Alert. That guy's going to get home bobbing and weaving like that. He's going to get home 1 minute sooner than everybody else if he doesn't cause a wreck. Voice Alert is an interesting thing that Bob Bruninga has put into APRS, and it actually was just an idea. It didn't require any integration. I think I see Skyline. And his point is, you drive down the highway, especially out in the rural territory, even when there's no digipeters around, you're beaconing every minute or so, and there could be other hams around you, but how would you know? Especially another ham that's traveling your direction. And you could get on 5-2 every couple of minutes and announce yourself, but that'll get old pretty quick. So with a Voice Alert, you encode a 100 hertz tone on your APRS beacon, and you set your APRS receiver. Well, you can't set your APRS receiver to decode 100 because the digipeters won't send that. You have to set something else to decode it. This Kenwood D710 has the feature built in. You can set it up so that it will decode the digipeters without tone, but it will also play an APRS packet brap with 100 hertz tone if someone else is transmitting it. So you'll hear their packet brap. And I kind of forget what I did, but I think you can set some message in there that says what voice frequency you're listening to. So down here on the Kenwood, I've got the right side transmitting and receiving APRS, and the left side sitting on 5.2, and the message says I'm listening on 5.2. But you can actually make a quick voice transmission on, say you hear a packet brap come blasting through because you got the volume turned up, and you know, okay, somebody's using a voice alert. You can go right there on the APRS channel and very briefly say, KM4AQ, I'm listening voice on 5.2. And the guy that was doing voice alert, in theory, will hear that, and if he really wants to talk, switch over to 5.2. Now, if you're going the same direction, you can talk for a while. If you're going opposite directions, you'll be out of range in a minute. But at least you know somebody else is out there. I turned that on and forgot about it. It's probably what I heard back in Austin when I heard that big loud packet brap. Haven't heard it from anybody else. I have had a long conversation with a guy. I started on a repeater heading west out of Jackson, and we were both going to be out of range of that repeater pretty quickly. So we switched to simplex, and I asked if he had 5.2, and he didn't. Didn't have 5.2. In the area he was, they used 147.54 or 146.54 for a simplex channel, so I'm able to quickly dial that in. Didn't have it on any of my radios, but I can dial it in on the VFO very quickly. And we talked for probably a half hour until he reached his destination. And of course, I went sailing on by with many more hours to go. There's downtown Houston. We'll be filling the screen in just a moment. See one building peeking up over there, but when I go over this rise, you should see it pretty well. But that conversation just started on a voice repeater. It didn't start on a voice alert. Okay, there's the skyline. So once again, that's one of those features that would be really great if a lot of people used it. I probably passed a large handful of hams that I could have had a simplex contact with. There could very well be somebody who's paralleling my track. Right here pulling into Houston, and I don't know. You know, I've got some friends here in Houston, folks that moved from North Carolina. Walter, if you're watching these shows, KM4BU, wave at you. I don't have time to stop. And people ask how I can manipulate all these radios and drive at the same time. I guess you're seeing that. I pay attention to them very briefly. And in traffic like this, I don't pay attention to them very often. Okay, there's the Houston skyline. That's more like it. Okay, so my beacon went out and it has been digipeded twice. All right, we are now headed out of Houston. And I really don't feel like manipulating radios to see what, if I can talk to somebody, because this traffic is just a little bit too heavy. I'm in bumper-to-bumper traffic at rush hour going through Beaumont, Texas, and I'm talking to Paul. So, Paul, let me have you say hello to the entire world through YouTube, something that may appear on Ham Radio Now, hopefully before the end of the week. I'll try to get this done in a hotel one night. Not tonight. I'm going to get there too late, but say hello to the world.
All right. Hello, world. This is WA5UNJ in Beaumont, Texas. Heading north for another 30 minutes.
Tell me a little bit about Ham Radio here in Beaumont.
Good sized club here in Beaumont, slightly bigger club down in Nederland. And then we've got a club up in Coons, close to where I live.
This is Alpha Echo 5, Victor Victor. We do have an active ham community. There's another club that, I don't live in Beaumont any longer. I live in Comanille, and we have a club in Tyler County that is doing very well. And we have great relationships with our community leaders and our first responders and our emergency operations center. So we're very active in Aries and RACES up there.
I assume you guys do the incident command system and, you know, the NIMS and ICS and all those acronyms?
Yeah, I'm the emergency coordinator and the PIO for Tyler County, the RRL PIO, and also the co-chair of the local emergency planning commission. So we're all kind of tied in. All of our stuff is FEMA. It's all NIMS and ICS. We don't use any of the ARRL forms or any of those things anymore. We're pretty much operating under FEMA guidelines.
Let's see if anybody's on 60. Which microphone? Oh, that microphone. CQ60, LOCQ, CQ, CQ, calling CQ 60 meters, channel 5. This is Kilo November 4, Alpha, Quebec. Kilo November 4, Alpha, Quebec. Kilo November 4, Alpha, Quebec, Mobile 5, Lake Charles, Louisiana, on Interstate 10. Calling CQ 60 and listening. The channelized nature of 60 meters means that there could very well be people just sitting there listening. Squelching a radio is not too effective, especially this time of year when there's going to be a lot of lightning stuff, thunderstorms, as evening approaches. But here's something you can do. You can turn the RF gain down a little bit, and that quiets the audio a lot. But you'd still hear a voice come through, and it depends on the signal strength. And it occurs to me, I wish there were somebody to, oh, definitely CW there. Rolling right along. Bob Heil has talked about this RF gain thing. It's an interesting technique. I need a signal to try it with. I'm not hearing anybody here on 60, so let me send the antenna and the radio over to 40 meters. I'm going to take a moment for the Tar Heel to get down to 40, because I need a signal to demonstrate this. Bob talks about this now and then, this technique of quieting the background noise by rolling the RF gain back a little bit. But he keeps missing an important feature or aspect of doing that.
I've been typing in KB0WCX, and I'm not getting the right...
Okay, that's a good strong signal. Okay, so I've got the RF gain turned down a little bit, and the volume turned up.
Okay. Well, see now, that's what happens when you don't hear right. I could have sworn you were saying King Baker instead of King David.
And with a fairly strong signal, the result of that is that the background noise is very much suppressed. It doesn't sound like FM, but it sounds like FM in that you're not hearing a loud rush of background noise. So that's what Bob has demonstrated a couple times that I've seen on Ham Nation. What he misses is that when you do this, the AGC in the radio stops working. A couple of results of that are that the S meter goes up and just kind of sits. You don't see any S meter reading, or if you've got the RF gain down far enough, you don't see any. And you also don't have the AGC effect of making all the signals sound approximately the same volume, whether they're strong or weak with amplitude modulation. The stronger the signal is, the louder it is, and that's can be a problem. That's why AGC, or automatic volume control, automatic gain control, was invented. It is a circuit that operates at the RF level of the radio and will grab the audio circuits, and when the signal is very strong, it reduces them, and when the signal is weak, it increases them automatically, so that weaker signals and stronger signals have approximately the same volume. Well, when you roll the RF gain back, that stops working. So you turn the RF gain back.
Okay, I got that doggone spaceship noise
example.
In here, so I'm not getting a very good copyright at the moment, but...
So you set the volume for a strong signal, and the weak signal will be very low. I think that's what's going to happen here when this guy turns it over.
Movies that I was watching this afternoon, it's a series of shows called The Suspicions of Mr. Witcher.
Okay, so the guy he's talking to, the signal's quite a bit weaker. So now I would have to manually ride the volume control.
Tell me what it is again.
Revent, the one that's on TV, no regular network.
Now I'll turn the RF gain back up.
The series Revenge. I really enjoyed the first two seasons. Then they started to get too complicated with too many other twists. So now it's a cutthroat game of who's going to eliminate who.
We're not quite through season two yet.
Well, you've got a little ways to go, and I just sat down here a week or so back, maybe.
That station's signal is not all that much stronger, two, three S units or so, but he's very much more intelligible. But in any case, the point is the automatic gain control works when the RF gain is all the way up. It holds those two signals' volumes about the same. But
one at a time, Dirk.
Turn the RF gain down.
And then
it does quiet that background noise quite a bit.
Watch all of them, one right after the other. I steered clear of both of those.
Breaking bad, did you ever get hooked on? I didn't like that storyline either from what I read about it, and I finally started watching it. And we all got hooked on it.
So that's what Bob missed, that concept that when you turn the RF gain down, you're going to have... that loss of AGC action. If you're just talking to a single station and his signal is pretty consistent, there's not a lot of QSB, APRS, beacon, it's not a big deal. It's a very effective strategy. If you're on a net where you've got a really wide variety of signals and you want to hear everybody pretty well, then you're going to be adjusting the volume control quite a bit, or the RF gain, or both of them, to manually do the job that the automatic volume control or the automatic gain control would be doing for you. So it's still a very useful technique. It's one that not very many hams utilize, even if they're aware of it. I really don't use it all that much. I guess all that background noise, you know, that doesn't really bother us. It's kind of music to our ears. It's like as I'm driving along here, I've got an open, squelched receiver sitting on 144.39, and I like hearing those packet braps because I want to hear what the packet environment is. I could have that turned down. I'd be sending my beacons. Everything would be fine. And who likes that brap sound of packet, 1200 baud packet? But... it's music to my ears. So here's a bit of a surprise. I was listening on channel 19 and suddenly it sounded like a lot of heterodynes, and sounds like that part of the spectrum was open. And here, it's a beacon out of California. K6FRC. according to QRZ, it's Valley Springs, California. I don't know where that is, but it's California. And it's pretty strong. So let's tune across 10 meters and see if anybody's on. Something real weak on 28.4. And other than that, pretty much nothing else, even though the band is pretty well open to California. Hello, CQ, 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 CQ 10, hello, CQ. Calling CQ, CQ, CQ. This is Kilo November 4, Alpha, Quebec. Kilo November 4, Alpha, Quebec. Kilo November 4, Alpha, Quebec, Mobile, Southern Louisiana. Calling CQ and listening.
Kilo November 4, Alpha Quebec. Buenas noches. Wiki, Papa 4, Gold Victor. Ángel David de la Isla del Encanto. Saludos, buenas noches.
Buenas noches. I did not copy your call sign. Went by a little too fast for me. My name is Gary, Golf Alpha Romeo Yankee. I am Mobile in southern Louisiana, going across Interstate 10. And your signal was pretty good, but I've had a lot of road noise in my ears for several hours, and I'm not hearing very well. Let me see if I can pull you through. One more time, go ahead, KN4AQ Mobile. Español. Yo hablo solamente un poco de español. Un poco de español. Buenas noches. Buenas noches. Me llamo Gary. G-A-R-Y. Golf Alpha Romeo Yankee. Gary. And that is about all the Spanish I know. Yo conoce un poco de español. So, 73. To Puerto Rico from Louisiana, 73, Buenos Noches, Kilo November 4, Alpha, Quebec.
Okay, amigo, copiado por acá.
Taxing my ability to speak Spanish. I took Spanish in high school. 2 years in high school, never became the least bit fluent, and have lost most of the vocabulary and just about all of everything else. Actually, taking Spanish taught me a lot more about English than it did about Spanish, about how irregular and convoluted our language is, and Spanish is only a little bit better. But that extra CQ at least pulled out of contact, and not from California. And there's that California beacon pounding in. With all the hams out there, you'd expect somebody else would be out here. But not too surprising, there's nobody there. Not even Gordon West. 81 miles to go. And no APRS beacons in this area. Oh, yeah, there was one. It was strong, too. didn't tell me where it was. But it appeared out of no place because I'd sent a bunch of beacons before and there was nothing, but there was. Ah, another cool bridge. And as you might have detected, darkness has fallen. Going through Baton Rouge. I don't think you can see over there on the right. It looks like a whole city lit up. One of those oil refineries. I'm talking to Cindy on my cell phone and she missed the part where I'm recording a program, so she's trying to talk back to me, but I'm ignoring her. Lots of APRS in the background. And I can see Baton Rouge downtown. One big, huge building off to the left. Again, probably out of your peripheral on the wide shot. Is this the Mississippi? I don't know. If it was, I missed the sign. I think it might be because something has got to go down toward New Orleans. How many big rivers like this can there be? So I guess we will wrap up this episode of Ham Radio Now on the road back home from Austin. If you enjoy this, and I know some of you do, stop by hamradionow.tv, find Arvin's icon, and feed the pig. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Over and out.